My name is Peter Gedrys. Welcome to the show today. I'm going to be talking to you in this session about finishes, coatings. I haven't got all day to really go over everything. I'm going to touch on a couple fairly completely, and I'm going to kind of waft over a few others. You're going to find out what my favorites are real soon just by doing that, okay? There's a lot of different coatings out there. There's oil-based, there's waterborne, and there's alcohol-based. The waterborne finishes are new generation of finishes. They don't have the toxicity, of course, that the oil-based finishes do. Basically, acrylic resins, colorless. They won't add a lot of color to your final look. That's a pro and a con. If you're looking to have your wood just stay very, very pale without any type of color, your waterborne finishes are the way to go. They're kind of funny to brush out, so there is a definitive learning curve. They don't want to be overbrushed. It's not like an oil finish where you can lay it on and brush it out nicely. Waterborne finishes really want to be laid on and left alone. If you come up with a holiday, a skip in the middle, avoid the temptation. How do I know that? Okay, go ahead and keep going. Paint pads are a wonderful way to apply waterborne finishes. You can find these in any hardware store. Little pads with a handle. I don't know what the covering is, but I'll dip those. What I'll do is I'll put a paper plate out and dip them into that. Touch them onto another paper plate with paper towels on them just to empty them, and then just draw it down. Draw it lightly, recharge and draw it, okay? But to be honest with you, I don't use waterborne finishes. I am not yet a convert, but they are good coatings to use, okay? And they'll serve you well. Are they suitable for spraying? Certainly. When all else fails, read the directions. They will give you directions on how to spray, but absolutely you can. They spray a little bit differently. They're a little viscous. Some are made just for spraying. Their viscosity is a little less. Okay, they're not quite as thick. Simplicity personified. These gel top coats. I got thumbs up already. Okay, simple to use. Very, very simple. Just kind of wipe them on with the finish and then draw them even and stop. Okay, when it dries, give it a light sanding. Do it again. Okay, very, very simple to use. I don't use these either. We're gonna get to something I use, believe me, we'll get there, okay? But they, for small projects, understand I do projects that are fairly large. I always love having saw miser start when I start. Is that a little better? I can outdo them. All right. Great for small projects. Simplicity. If you're working in a basement shop, there's no smell, okay? There's not really any toxicity involved unless you're drinking it, which you're not gonna do. Follow directions. It says do not ingest, okay? Now, going to the other end of the spectrum, I do a lot of lacquer work. As a professional, I spray a fair amount, okay? I also use varnishes. Oil-based varnishes, and there is a myriad of different types of varnishes out there. Listed on the side are the ingredients. Varnish is not that complex a material. It has a resin, an oil, and a carrier, the solvents, and probably a dryer in there. If it's satin, they have some silica in there to have it not be so glossy. The alkyd resin, A-L-K-Y-D, alkyd resins. They have a little less color, and when used in a soya-based oil like this, pretty colorless, clear oil-based varnish. Because one of the knocks on varnishes, if somebody's trying to keep a light, pale color, it will yellow over time. The alkyd varnishes tend to yellow less than the phenolic resins. Phenolic resins are a little bit tougher, a little bit more amber in color. You'll see phenolic resins in varnishes like Waterlocks. Okay, good tough varnish. You'll see it in the exterior varnishes. It's a tougher resin. Great stuff. One of my all-time favorites. Going this way, Armin. shellac. I use lots of shellac. You see what's in this bottle? That's what's in this can. Blonde shellac. If you get a chance later on, just walk by the end of this. There's a progression of how raw shellac happens with stick lac, then seed lac, then button lac. Who here eats shellac? I know I do. And every one of you do. How do you like that? On its matter of importance, from 1 to 20, in wood finishing is number 14 in shellac's importance. Number 1 is the pharmaceutical industry. Wax, shellac has a natural wax to it. And we all know nothing is wasted in commerce. I feel like Michael Jackson. Nothing is wasted in commerce. The wax is taken out, and it's used as a coating on pills, time-release pills, shiny coating on apples, jelly beans, etc., etc. See where I'm going? You eat a lot of shellac. It's one of those great natural products. It's like silk. Man has been able to come up with synthetics, but nothing can match silk. Nothing matches shellac. It does have its pros and cons. I've had people say to me, well, you can't do shellac on walls. I said, well, why? Well, it's not waterproof. I took my empty coffee cup. I said, well, I don't think we're going to have standing water on that now, are we? The point was, it makes a great finish. A great finish. Nice hard resin. Makes a beautiful coating. And it dries like this. Okay? You can build a lot of coats in one day. Now, just to get started, I think we're going to go ahead and start playing with some varnish. There's a door that I varnished up yesterday. It's pretty glossy. You can see that. If my schedule is going to be 3 coats of varnish, but I want a satin look, my first 2 coats are going to be gloss. Want to know why? It has a nice, clear, deep look. There's no contaminants, there's no stearates in there to muddy my look. Always build with gloss, always. If you want a satin, use it as your final coat. Otherwise, it kind of has a cloudy, hazy look, and you're going to be scratching your head saying, I know this could be look better, but you don't quite know why. Okay, build with gloss. Now, varnish is one of those coatings that wants to be abraded before you add another coat. Think of Velcro. Give it some tooth. The first coat gets sanded, that second coat has tooth to bond with it. There are some varnishes, they say, you go ahead, you don't have to sand in between coats. Don't. I'm going to come up with a better finish than you are because I'm sanding in between coats. I'll probably have some dust nibs in it. I always use these eyes first. I close my eyes and I use these eyes. It's a little bit nibby there, not too bad. I'm starting to build my mil thickness now. That's the coating, the thickness of the coating. There's about 3 mils of thickness on here. If it was really bad, I could hit it with 220, but I'm just gonna use 320. Now, the purist will tell you I'm already wrong because I have not got a sanding block, okay? Theoretically, I should have a sanding block here because I make the surface perfectly flat and level, okay? One of the things you'll read on a surface when you're sanding, you'll see some shiny spots and some dull spots, right? You know what that is? Hills and valleys. Hills and valleys. When you're brushing on a coat, it's not always completely flat or even. You have miniature hills and valleys. So when I start to sand the surface, you see the shiny areas still here? I just hit it with the sandpaper a little bit. I've just kind of knocked off those hills a little bit. I'm not quite down to the valley yet. Now, with that said, you got to watch out when you get down to the valley because you can sand through. And then you get what we call witness lines. And somebody was astute to observe that I had a drip mark in this. Who was it? It was you. That was you. Okay. Good eyes. I won't bite you too hard. Doing samples in an uncontrolled condition like this, sometimes you get mistakes, and thank you for pointing it out. Thank you.
Glad to help.
I'm sure you are. Keep it up and you'll be up here doing this. And I'll be sitting down. Don't oversand. You don't want to be going through because varnishes are separate layers. Separate, distinct layers. If you sand too far, you're going to get something we call a witness line, where you've gone through to that second layer, and they are a pain in the neck to fix. Okay? So be smart. Observe what you're doing. One, two, three. I'm going about three times across the panel. I'm going to stop and observe what I've got here. I know I had paper towels here. Whew. I'm all right. Okay, now when I read the surface, it looks a little bit more uniformly dull. You see it? I've gotten most of the hills down. I'm pretty close to the valley. I'm going to stop. I'm going to start working on my rails and stiles. Try not to hook your fingers on the bench and dislocate it. It doesn't hurt to be ambidextrous when you're working, especially if you have the light exactly where you want it. Anybody here ever steal wool in between coats? Don't. Steel wool fits itself to those hills and valleys and doesn't cut the hills off. It doesn't really give you the tooth that you want. It doesn't cut. It tends to more polish, okay? If you're using a waterborne coating, never use steel wool between coats. You leave any of those shards in between, and what happens with metal and water? Rust. If you're smart, you can say it's character. Okay? Use it as a design feature. I can't hear you. No, do not use wools between coats of finish. That's why God made sandpaper. If you'll excuse me using the analogy, okay? Once I go ahead and get my surface sanded well, I'm going to clean well. Now, let's face it, dust is the enemy to a slow drying finish, but I don't worry too much about that because I know I'm always going to rub out my top coat anyways, okay? Okay, let's give this a quick wipe down. Compressed air. I don't use tack rags. The question was tack rag. You know those commercial tack rags you can use? They have stickies on them? Nope. I could leave some contaminants behind or some kind of resin or something behind. First, do no harm. I just use a nice clean cloth. Actually, I buy, by the case, used hospital sheets. They make, after I clean something, I might even wipe this down real quickly with some denatured alcohol. It's not going to harm the varnish at all. I'll get the dust off it. Okay, here's where you're all going to start shaking your heads. This is usually a lot of fun for me. When choosing your brush, this is where a lot of arguments start. When choosing your brush for a varnish, you want the best quality brush you can get, right? Because it's going to lay down the best coating. This is what I use. I know. On the flats, this is what I use. There's no brush marks. There's no brush strokes. I have no waste solvent to generate to clean my brush later on, right? That probably costs 40 cents for all you frugal types, okay? And it's very simple to manipulate. The big argument I hear, well, it'll put bubbles in the finish. No, it won't. You will. A touch of care, and it's simple. Watch. It's so simple. I've taught more people how to use these things. If you're going to use a bristle brush, the very first thing you do is clean it. Don't open it up and use it. You're going to have all these hairs and dust and dirt in the finish and go, something. There was something in that varnish. Yes, sir. I can't hear you. That's a good question. Do I have to make sure I have every little bit of gloss off of this? I'd probably do a little bit more to this, but I'm not going to be to the point where I have absolutely every spot touched. I can't say I'm not. I would say if I have 98%, I'm a happy guy. Good question. Clean your brush, whatever solvent, mineral spirits you're going to use, okay? Using what? Shop hair?
Compressed air.
Oh, okay. It can be contaminated?
Yeah.
Then don't use it. Vacuum?
Yeah.
Okay.
I changed the vacuum, but I don't know if there's anything better.
Stirring sticks. Go buy a box of tongue depressors. I love these things. Always work out of a separate container. Do not work out of your can of finish. Two main reasons, and for those of you who were here before, you know my first reason. Gravity. You ever knock something over? At the worst possible moment, when you only have a little bit of finish left, you will knock it over. Remember I told you that. Do not shake your varnish. I prefer to stir it. I don't need a lot for this. Normally I would just pour this out, but I don't have a nail or an awl to punch holes in the rim here so it'll drain. So I'm just gonna stick a little bit of varnish in my container. Now to be fair, when I'm doing areas with moldings and panel hips on the panel, I will in fact use a bristle brush. And this is where I spend my money. I know you can't see it that well, but maybe take a walk up later on. If your hands are dirty, please don't touch the bristles that much, if you can help it. This is called a flat wash brush. Artist supply houses have things like this. This is ox ear hair. It's exceedingly soft. It will form itself to a molding and lay down the slickest, nicest coating, okay? It has a little bit of chisel to the ends, all right? That's probably a $28 brush, okay? So to be fair, I do use brushes too. Okay, before I use any brush, I charge it. What I mean is I get a little bit of its solvent in it. I know a lot of you have already seen me use this trick. You ever open up one of these cans and go to pour it just a little bit and it just slobbers all over? Me too. Crack it, an eighth of a turn, and you now have a squeeze bottle. Did you see that real quick? Just a tiny, tiny little bit poured out, you can make a squeeze bottle. Most of the cans in my shop have these middles, like, okay, from squeezing them. I put a little bit of solvent, this happened to be mineral spirits, into my brush. Charge it. Always charge any brush, whatever you're doing first, okay? There's mineral spirits for oil solvents, and there's naphtha. The only difference between these two is this one evaporates quicker. It has the same cutting strength and ability. This one evaporates faster than the mineral spirits. That's the only difference. Okay, here's the key. If you take a sponge and push it down into a basin, what's gonna happen? You're gonna put bubbles in it, right? You do that and you put the bubbles in your varnish, then it's a possibility. Well, I don't do that. All I do is just stick my brush in about half an inch or so. Remember, this is gonna wick into the brush. I'll do it again. Again, using gravity, you'll see it charging in to that brush. I'm starting to load that brush up. I have more than enough varnish to do the panel and probably the rails just on this charge, okay? This could have been dusted a whole lot better. Not bad. Don't pull from an edge. If you pull from an edge, can everybody see that already? There's that thing about gravity again. Is it working? Okay. If you see them right away, that's fine. Wipe them off. If you see them when the varnish is starting to dry, what we call tack-free, where it's no longer going to have, it's a little bit dry to the touch, but not completely dry, avoid the temptation to try to get them off then. Or when it's still, you're going to smear it, okay? And you're going to be reaching for it. You're going to want to get those out. Pull the reins in on yourself. Let it set up. Use a razor blade. Okay? You try to sand it, you're going to sand all around it, and that lump is still going to be there. Use a razor blade to lightly scrape it or cut it. I have not one bubble in this varnish. Not one. And all brushes are not created equal. I'm on camera, so I can't say names and really diss them, but there's one major company that's a big giant chain store that has everything in the world. It's kind of a depot. Those brushes are not very good. Something like Woodcraft carries a brush. They actually have inside here, there's a little piece of plastic that gives it a little stability. They're great foam brushes. The other thing I see students do when they first work with varnish and a foam brush, it's this fear. They're going to be so utterly careful. Let the varnish do the work. It's not hard. Go started from the middle, brushed out to either side. I'm putting a little bit of pressure down on, but not much more than my hand pressure. That brush needs to be recharged. I'll put a little varnish in there. Let it soak in. I'm ready to go again. And you see, I'm being somewhat carefree about this. But there's a design carefreeness about it. I have a light touch going and brushing it out. A standard way with a brush is to lay your varnish on and then do what we call tipping out. You work almost perpendicular to the surface. I'm doing about the same thing right now. You can't do this with an oil, a waterborne finish, okay? You can go ahead and cut in those panels. I tend to put my other arm behind me for some reason. Keeps it out of the way. I see I can't say I'm not being careful, but I'm not being afraid either. I would do this probably, like I said, the hips with a bristle brush. I'm gonna reload my brush again. The sequence is always rails first and then styles. By brushing this on and giving it a light brushing, somewhat leveling it out. Now, this is a slow drying finish. Let it work. Let it flow. Okay? And don't think you're going to get away putting on one thick coat of varnish instead of two or three thin ones. Bad judgment. Thin coats dry and cure faster than thick coats do. Okay? I'm going to be hearing that guy in my sleep tonight. He's probably saying the same thing over there. If you can change hands, all the better. Some of you heard me say this yesterday. I had college students that I was teaching, and I learned their dominant hand. On one day, I would put a glove on that hand. They were not allowed to work with anything but the clean hand. I forced them to use their other hand. You got two of them. Might as well get used to using them. Okay, I'm done. That's a pretty nice, thin, even coating of varnish. I didn't go crazy. What did that take me? 3 minutes? Okay? Don't make yourself nuts with this. When you start to get too anal, you start to mess up. A light touch, proper technique, let the varnish do the work, set it aside. Okay? One good little trick if you can do is clean at the end of the day in your shop or wherever you're working, clean at the end of the day and varnish the next day. One of the things I'll do before I start to work, if I'm doing varnishing, is I go around and sprinkle water around on the floor. helps keep the dust down. Real simple. I'm very lucky I have radiant floor heat, so I have to do it a number of times because it starts to dry on me fairly quickly. Now let's put this aside. I hope that doesn't. If that starts to smell, let me know. I'll move it out of the way. All right. Now, unfortunately, in my color seminar, I forgot to say this to you, and this is exceedingly important. If any of you are here for the color, and I had those oily rags from the gel stain, do not wad those up and put them in the corner. You'll be calling 911 after it combusts. Okay? It's going to ruin your day, I promise. Hang them outside, put them in a ball, and throw them in the, somewhere on the side. I'm going to go ahead and just put this away for now. Put this onto the side. Okay, let's have some fun with shellac. Do I use a lot of lacquers? I do. Spray them. I don't brush lacquers. Those are good for very small projects. Okay. Shellac from the bug Coccus laca or Lassifer laca. I already told you how much shellac you eat. It is an important product. It's one of the greatest finishing materials there is. The knock on it is, well, if we get water on it, it's a problem. This is a shellac surface, you know? If we got water on it, oh my God, it's a major problem. Wipe it off. Okay? Well, if you leave a glass on it, it'll mark. Well, a lot of finishes will mark. Okay? And usually everybody looks at it as a major catastrophe if something liquid gets spilled on a table. It's like a fire drill. Everybody's, you know? Do I use shellac on a dining table? I have. On some period pieces I have, yes. I French polish them. But side, I have a side table. I have a little maple side table. It's right next to my bed. Tiger maple table, shellac and wax. I have a bottle of water on it. I don't have any problems, okay? Is it alcohol resistant? It's resistant but not proof. If you spill some wine or something on it, will it mar it? If you leave it sit there over time, yes. Right away, instantaneously, is it a catastrophe? No. Okay, these are some of these myths that you hear about shellac. Now, shellac can be brushed, it can be sprayed, and it can be padded. One of my favorite ways to work with shellac is a pad. Okay? All this pad is, I've got some over here, is a very high grade of cheesecloth. And there's a lot of things that people use. They'll use cotton wadding, hospital wadding, wool socks. I happen to like this, personally. It's just a good high grade of cheesecloth with a linen-like cover. And I've got pads that are 3 and 4 years old. I'll just keep using them. Shellac is reversible. What does that mean? I can pour alcohol on here and redissolve it. Once that varnish is dry, I can pour mineral spirits and it can sit there for 3 months. It will not harm it. It is non-reversible. Okay? This is a solvent release finish. I make up a pad and I'll show you how I make them in a minute. But I'll make one up, make it comfortable in my hand. There's a lot of different ways to do this, but I put the cover on it. The most important criteria here is not to have any wrinkles in the face. Let your eyes do the, okay? I'll pull it closed, I'll wrap it up, flatten that pad out. And you can see my hand is probably less than an eighth of an inch from the surface. So when I'm padding, I'm right down. I've got a great feel and touch for this. Now, shellac can be brushed also. The first coat on raw wood is child's play. You can actually brush back and forth with it fairly quickly, but it does evaporate like this, okay? It's your second and third coats that tend to take a little more care. So I'm brushing on a coat. I'm going to brush the same thing as I would a waterborne finish. I'm not going to be overbrushing it. I'm going to lay it on. I'm going to let it sit. The question I had yesterday was, what happens when I get a brush stroke there? Well, maybe a light scraping with a razor blade, light sanding, it'll take that out. Brushing shellac does take a touch, okay? But I absolutely love padding shellac. Let me show you how I make a pad. I was teaching a French polishing class one time, and I had a gentleman finally get it on how to make his pad. And he was holding this thing like it was the Holy Grail. It was beautiful, it was nicely shaped, it was perfectly formed. I said, let me see that. I took it and I shook it out, rolled it up, and I said, now do it again. I swear to God, his face went pale. I'm not gonna be there to do it in your shop, so do it again. Practice, practice, practice. I thought that was a riot, he didn't. I'm gonna cut myself off about a 12-inch piece here. I hope my wife's not looking for these scissors this weekend. Got a fairly nice sized piece of cheesecloth here. One of the ways people do it is they'll fold each corner in, okay? I've gotten to the point where I just take it, fold it over. You don't want to have a lot of wrinkles in it. Fold it over, and then I just kind of curl it. I curl it into itself. You ever seen a baker make a roll? It's about the same thing, okay? But now I've got this nice little elliptical face. There is the core of my pad, okay? Now the outer material we use is like a linen. Bed sheets, t-shirts, they're way too thick. They won't discharge the shellac properly and they'll wrinkle and leave a mar on the face, okay? So I'll cut a square that's probably about 8 inches. If anybody wants to try this, you can't buy this stuff in small quantities. I buy this by the 75-pound box. Just put it on the diagonal. You have to play with it a little bit. Pull it down. I'll wrap it around in my hand. Give it a little smack. All right, there's the start of my pad. Pretty simple. Let me put some gloves on. When you're working with shellac, wear gloves, okay? Why? Alcohol will absorb through the skin, right? Well, what is denatured alcohol? Denatured alcohol is ethanol, grain alcohol. It's the methanol, the poison they put into it, that makes it denatured. If it's denatured, you can't drink it. If you can't drink it, you don't have to pay the liquor tax. Denatured alcohol. Do you remember how I charged up my brush? Well, I'm gonna do the same thing with my pad. I'm gonna go ahead and charge it. I'm gonna crack that about 1/8 of an inch. I think it had a vacuum in there. Let's try this again. I'm gonna crack it 1/8 of an inch. Watch, make a nice little, see how controlled that is? Nice little squeeze bottle. I put in about 1 tablespoon of alcohol, roughly. Okay, he's an engineer. I was giving him a hard time before. Any other engineers on this side? Oh, that's why you looked at me. Okay. Don't put your pad down on nothing but respect for engineers, honestly. I'll go ahead and wet my outer cloth too. This is just my initial charging of my pad. I absolutely love shellac. It's one of my favorites. Shellac will lend itself and have a fire that no other finish does inherently. This is de-waxed orange shellac. It's almost jewel-like. Now you get that on the surface, it's unbelievable. The amber shellac you can buy is also orange shellac, but it's not de-waxed. I used to make all my own blonde shellac. Grind up the flakes, put them in denatured alcohol, okay? Thankfully, they started making blonde shellac for us. Now, if you look on the can, it'll say 2-pound cut. What that means is there's 2 pounds of these flakes to each gallon of alcohol. That is a 2-pound cut. If you look at the amber in a clear shellac, it'll say 3-pound cut. That's 3 pounds of flakes to 1 gallon of alcohol. I can work quite happily with this shellac right out of the can in the 2-pound cut. Some people like to cut it back to 1.5 pounds. I don't know exactly what that is, but it's a little bit thinner. You know, this Again, I would have this poured out into a separate container. I'm going to load it. When I first load it, I'm going to squeeze it in there, but I don't want it dripping wet. I want to charge. This is called charging the pad. I want to put a fairly good charge to it initially. Cover your cans. Now, I'm not going to tell you this doesn't take practice, but I can't cut dovetails, and I bet a lot of you guys can. I can't carve, but I'll bet a lot of you guys can. But I can French polish. It takes a time. Now, this is not French polishing by any stretch of the imagination, okay? But this is. That's a French polished handrail. I just finished this particular job. This was the color study and the sample for the job. Six floors of continuous mahogany handrails in a brownstone on the upper side of New York. Okay, always do samples. That's French polishing. This is padding shellac. Okay, I'll tap it on my hand. Make sure the hand is dry. You don't want to put your hand down on that because there's already shellac on that surface. Let's get a little bit of shellac on here. I'm going to land on this, and once I land, I'm going to keep a continuous presence of my pad on that surface. And you'll notice that I'm making an elongated figure eight at the top of the stroke. And I'm telling you, I'm actually holding the weight off my hand right now, okay? Because I have a fairly well-charged pad. It's fairly well loaded with shellac. I don't want to come down too hard and put too much or squeeze out. I'm going to have to tip it towards me for a moment. There's times when I check. Some people check on the side of their hand. I just normally check. What I'm feeling is how much of a charge I have in that pad, how wet it is, okay? Somebody heard me say this yesterday. I was working with some garnet shellac one day for the whole day, and I kept checking my charge on against my eye. My wife got home that night and said, "Somebody hit you?" I had this nice big mark under my eye, and she was very disappointed when I told her it was just shellac. Well, I don't know, I hope it was fake disappointment, but. Now again, I'm just letting the weight of my hand, because I know I have a fairly good charge in here. But the great thing about this, that's almost dry already. Isn't that cool? You can lay down whisper thin coatings, and it's tacky. I'm not pressing my hand into it. What do you think would happen if I pressed my hand into that varnish? It would look like a dinosaur track, and it would stay there, okay? Now let's let that sit for 1 second. Here's a piece of mahogany that the reporter who came in yesterday dyed up for me, and I put a gel stain over it. That's the color underneath. For those of you who weren't here for the color presentation, that's the first color, what I call my ground color. Then I went over it with a brown mahogany gel stain. Has some nice life to it, doesn't it? I'm gonna go ahead and dip my pad up again. I'm gonna get it a little bit more wet because this wood has absolutely no shellac on it yet, and I'm gonna go ahead and put a quick sealer coat on this. Open up your, take your lid off, your cover off. Just a little bit, you don't need much. Think of taffy. You can stretch a shellac flake a long, long way. You don't need a lot. That's a great thing about a French polish, is an exceedingly thin finish that is just beautiful, it's marvelous. When you get done doing it right. And there's a lot of people out there, any shiny coating they make, they call it French polished. Not so. Okay, French polishing is done with shellac. I'm gonna go ahead and go around in a circle, start my bodying up phase. I'm starting to body up the shellac. This takes practice. But you'll notice I have yet to leave the surface of this wood, but I haven't stopped either. What I'm doing is going around and around in circles and pulling over each circle that I'm working with, because eventually I'm gonna start to, well, they're not clapping for me. They're gonna start to straighten this those circles out. And now I'm starting to put a little bit more pressure down. The biggest mistake you'll make as amateurs is loading your pad too often. Work the pad out. There's a little bit of color on there. It's just a little bit of surface color. Work the pad out before you start to recharge. But I've already gotten a sealer coat on here. A little bit marked up, but I didn't have to brush anything. It went fairly quick. It's nice and thin, right? Simple. It's pretty simple. This is a great tool once you learn how to use it. Remember what we just finished doing? Dry as a bone. Amazing, isn't it? Let me build up a little more shellac on this. One of the things with shellac, a lot of people will put a little bit of oil on their pad, okay? It's like Linus's blanket.
When you padded that, you put dust back on that.
Oh, well.
Is that going to go into the finish?
I'll sand it. I don't worry about too much. I've been married 26 years. A little dust in my finish is not going to bother me in the least, okay? And I say that with all deference. She's giving me a dirty look. I do. I'm starting to press down a little bit more. My pad is starting to work out. I'm starting to lose the charge. I can also start to manipulate that surface and move it around, believe it or not. Chemically, I'm moving that surface. Not pulling it off, but I'm burnishing it. This gives such a lovely finish once you learn how to use a pad. Now again, I cannot see what I'm doing here. Sometimes I'll just close my eyes and work by feel. I can feel that surface underneath my hand. If I find my hand starting to skip, I know the pad is too dry, okay? But again, she's starting to build up a nice surface there. It's thin, it's not a real thick finish, and look, whoops, that's a little tacky, but not bad, okay? Isn't that a great product? I find a lot of woodworkers are fearful of shellac because it dries fast. That's one of the things I love most about it. All right? Learn to make it work for you. You can easily tint your shellac if you'd like. There's alcohol-soluble dyes that you can purchase from somebody like Woodcraft. These are called trans tints. They are alcohol-soluble dyes. Let's say I want to use a little bit in some shellac. I'd probably take about an inch of shellac, put two or three drops, color my shellac, and then add that to the stock that I'm using. Don't go ahead and put this in right to what you're using. You may make it too dark and ruin the batch. Keep control over what you're doing. Put a little bit in, make a little concentrated solution, drop it into your shellac. Now you made a colored shellac. Great stuff. Okay. Whew. You're all experts. All right? Don't be afraid to play with this stuff. If anybody, this is up to you, they're just here. I brought some with me because nobody's ever able to buy these. They're little bags, cheesecloth with the covers on them if anybody wants some. Shellac will also make a great sealer coat. Let's say I want to go ahead and varnish this piece. Well, I've already sealed it. Don't ever put your pad down on the surface. Remember that sealer I just put on? Dry. Now imagine doing this to vertical walls. I have actually French polished a couple of interiors. You want to talk about getting arm weary? I'm ambidextrous, but I could get about 5 hours in at the end of the day and I'd just about be crying. My shoulders would hurt so bad. You know what made them feel better? Getting paid. Because I got paid well to do that. I earned it, and I'm telling you, I earned every penny of it. I'm going to pass this around in about 3 minutes, okay? I'm going to entertain some questions here. So what have we covered? We've talked about waterborne finishes, if you need a clear coating without any yellowing to it. We've talked about oil-based varnishes, wipe-on urethanes. If you want to take a thicker varnish right out of the can and cut it with about 50% mineral spirits, you'll make your own wiping varnish. Simple. There are wiping varnishes available. I think this gel top coat's one of those easy ones to use. Okay. And we talked about one of my favorites, shellac. Don't be afraid to use this product. Get to know it a little bit. If you're ever looking for something to put your pad down because you haven't got quite everything you need at the same time, just turn your glove inside out, okay? That's a pretty darn nice looking finish for about like 5 minutes of work, okay? You don't have to have a thick finish to have it be good, so don't be afraid to play with this stuff. And remember, that was the base color. Oh my God, you can't put orange on mahogany. Yes, you can. Okay. Questions? Any questions? We start back there. You're going to have to speak up. Hang on 1 second. Polyurethane. I didn't mention it. Polyurethane, I'm sorry. I did not cover it. Polyurethane is another one of those top coats. Pretty abrasion resistant. Good tough coating. I don't use it, and there's lots of camp that will just, you can't use your, it's just finishing. If that's what you're comfortable using and you like the way it looks, it's the perfect finish for you, okay? It brushes out just like the oil-based varnish that I used. Nothing wrong with it at all. Once it cross-links and it cures real well and you want to put other coats on, you really have to scuff it very well because it doesn't like to bond to itself. That's one of the cons. It's kind of a brittle finish, okay? Sir? What about tungue oil? As a finish, it's lousy. Did I just destroy a bunch of myths on that statement? Tungue oil as a finish by itself is not that good. Tungue oil in a varnish is a great product. A tungue oil-based varnish is a great product. One of the analogies used in finishing and finishes, if you take water, flour, and yeast, and you bake them, you come out with a whole different product called bread. If you take tungue oil, which is a drying oil is an oil that will dry by oxidation without any other components added to it, just like boiled linseed oil will. It's a drying oil. If you cook tungue oil with the proper resins and you come out with a tungue oil varnish, none better. Okay? That's what Waterlox is, tungue oil and phenolic resin. Pretty tough product. Questions? Go ahead. Will I rub out a shellac finish? Sometimes I will. Sometimes I will. It depends on the look I'm going for, okay? Sometimes it's a little shiny. Look at that, it's dry already. Sometimes it's a little shiny. I may take a little steel wool. And if you're gonna buy steel wool, do yourself a favor. And again, I'm not a shill for the company, but I'm telling you, as a product, I use this a lot. It's by far and away the best steel wool you can get, Liberon. Okay? Good stuff. Can't even find the beginning to it. It doesn't come in those little pads that you, sometimes those pads that you get at those big box stores, they're full of oil. Okay? This is considered oil free. I'll just take off the piece that I need. Sometimes I'll put a little wax on it and I'll rub out a surface, just kind of soft sheen, nice touch. Because what does everybody do on a finished piece? What's the first thing they do? They look up at you and they run their hands on it. They don't care all the work and the great color you did. Is it smooth? Then you're successful. You know what I do to people when they walk into my shop? I have it set up, good lights, I have skylights. I turn around and as I'm talking, I let them walk over and I know their hand's just about to land on it. And as soon as the hand touches it, I say, whatever you do, just don't touch it. Just to amuse myself, okay? But this is what people look with, all right? So look at this when you get a chance. She's dry, has a nice glow to it, okay? Great stuff. Try shellac, all right? Put that into your arsenal. It's a great product. Questions? Yeah.
Different species of woods have more appropriate finishes, say an open grain like mahogany versus a tighter grain.
Do different species of wood have different finishes? No. It's a matter of whether you fill the pores of the wood or not. I didn't even get into pore filling here. That'll be next year. You gotta wait a whole year for that. Go ahead. How do you get a water stain? Is it black or white? Oof, You take the finish off, you put a bleach poultice of oxalic acid on it a couple of times, then wash it well, give it a light sanding, and then refinish. I know, thanks. I know your eyes just rolled white. I knew they were going to. You asked. I got a better, wait. I got a better way. And this is the God's honest truth. I was interviewing for a job at a large corporate place early in my career to do touch-ups. And I had this one bean counter I was walking around with. This young lady kept saying, you know, it's got to be quick and cheap. It's got to be quick and cheap. I said, okay. After about, I don't have a lot of patience. After about half an hour of this, we go into one VP's office and she goes, on this credenza, it's got to be quick and cheap. I went to the guy, I said, sir, may I? He said, sure. I said, that's quick and cheap. I didn't get the job, but, you know, okay. Camouflage. I can't hear you. Well, how many coats do I, what, on this? You can keep going. The question was, how many coats of shellac do I put on? When I get done, no matter what, it's one coat, because remember, it melts into itself. How many times did I go over it until I was pleased here and here? Three, four, five times, okay? I'd probably body this up a little bit more, but it's a thin coating. Shellac likes to be nice and thin. It doesn't have to be fat and thick, okay? Let me get back here for a second. I love spraying shellac, but it sprays a whole lot different than lacquer does. You have to have a lighter touch and a quicker hand. Okay, go ahead, sir. Yes. Good question. If I'm going to put a varnish top coat over my shellac, I'm just going to put on a coat or two of shellac, sand it, level it, clean it, and start with my varnish. I'm not going to build up the shellac coating. I'm just using it as a sealer coat. I use it right out of the can. I love this stuff. Works like a charm. Do I sand between the padding coats? No. I may sand, you know, if I'm going to body this up a couple more times, I'd probably wait, give this a light sanding, and then have at it again. But the fact is that it melts into itself, so it reacts right with that shellac that's on there as I started to work it on. If you do sand your shellac and you're going to pad, good question. Come with a light touch because the shellac's going to bite quick, okay? It's going to bite quickly. Until you get another layer of that on there and it starts to work again. You'll see what I mean when you do that, if you do it. And you should do it. Yes?
What product do you recommend
to do? Oh, Tinaven 265. That's the additive, I'm sorry. A good UV film on a window. There are spar varnishes. Marine varnishes have UV protectors built in. Shades.
Dirt?
No, not dirt. Dirt, UV will get through dirt, okay? Some of the spar varnishes, the marine varnishes, have UV protectors built in. You know, light's gonna do its thing. Dirt on the windows, somebody up here is being a wise guy. You know, curtains. It works in his house. Well, thanks, we needed to know that. Questions? That's it, all right, I expect a lot out of you. Okay? Have fun. Thank you.